besides the desk part, is that everything passed after that mutual authentication is in the clear. So I still see the security code. But as it's part of the standard, the mutual authentication is optional. So to say that you're doing C1221, all you have to do is say that you're doing it. You don't have to do anything else. It's a fucking lie. So the answer to that was C1222. They worked really hard at creating a standard so that for that supported networking, TCP/IP, you can do C1222. The problem is they did an encryption protocol that had not been approved by NIST. NIST didn't approve it because it's vulnerable to attacks of if you send a back packet, and I might have this wrong, but I'm going to try to do the best I can. If you send small packets, 1-2 bytes, it's vulnerable to brute forcing the key. But in this protocol, you're never going to send anything, I think, less than 8 bytes. So it's not vulnerable to this attack. But because it's vulnerable and NIST won't approve it, therefore none of the vendors will implement this. And so NIST says they okay because they're working on interoperability standards. So now ANSI has to go back, fix this. It'll probably be about 2015. Then the vendors can start doing the development so those meters will get C1222 in about 20 years. I'm just kidding. I'm sure somebody's working on it.
Adigo ain't my baby!
Talking about the communications, this is actually the output from Soleil Logical Analyzer, and you're seeing actually the identification service response packet here. Okay, and this is where they say they're going to do C1221. They just changed that one byte. Okay, but what's important here is that the logical analyzer tells me what's going across these lines. As long as I configure it correctly, then it's smart, and it's just for this. Right here is just async serial. The NIC and the metrology board are just communicating via async serial. And what I can do is I can not only use the analyzers to show me what the data is parsing, but I can export it to a CSV file. And then you know where I'm going there. How does it look? Is that low res? Okay, good. It came up good. So now I can start labeling the packets. Okay. When I first got those standards that I was talking about, I read this for about 2 weeks because I'm really good at analyzing documentation and writing protocols and communications and stuff like that, and it completely baffled me. I was new to it, but as soon as I got this output, and as soon as I can start labeling these bytes, I'm like, oh man, now it makes sense. This is freaking awesome. I know exactly what they're doing. I know every part of that packet. What's great is, then I merge the files, because you export the receive pin, and then you export the transmit pin, and you can merge these files. Now you can see the full conversation, the request and response, the NIC card logging in, the metrology board saying, okay, so identification, negotiation, log on to security. Woohoo! That's a security code. Now I know how to log in. And if they're using that code for the optical port, that's what I'm hoping. Okay. Probably the next most important thing is the action. So the read, write, run procedures, because those are still kind of hard to understand, but also every manufacturer does it differently. So if I can see them, how they're doing the actions, now I can start programming that myself. And as I'm sitting there looking at these things, I'm sorry, let me talk about this real quick. The first tool in my toolkit is a basic parser that will take both of those files and merge them together, mark all that stuff, because it takes a long time to do all that by hand. So that was the first part of my toolkit, to speed things up. And as I'm writing that, I'm looking at it, I'm like, wait a minute. When I was working with Atlas, working on the MST430 disassembler and emulator, he told me, when you're working with Python, tables is the best way. Tables are the fastest thing to reference. I'm like, shit, I've got tables. Because every response and request is exactly the same. I mean, there's a slight difference. There's a control byte, but I can account for that. It's exactly the same. So I can just write table to table. If I can write the table of the communications, I know what's coming back. Now I can start generating my tools. Now that I have a persistent connection, now that I can start writing tools for that, I have an advanced persistent tether. Okay? I can communicate with the device. I can send things to it and see what kind of response it gets. If I do this correctly, if I just think about what normal replay attacks do, you just send a packet. And in this case, I didn't care what it returned. Well, I cared about what it returned, but I monitored to see what that response was. I didn't modify my behavior according to that response. And so I would send a packet. I would send that logon packet, negotiate packet, and all the way up to the security packet. If it came back, and when I analyzed the what it was sending in return, I logged in correctly. So now I've got a man-in-the-middle attack. Or a replay attack. So now I can receive responses via the logical analyzer, understand what's going on, know that I'm doing it right. And now I've got a hardware. This is the second one in my toolkit. You know, a hardware client to communicate with the meter, log in, see what those configurations are, and do it over and over again in a repeatable process. But I still have wires coming out of it. This is just in my lab, on my desktop. I'm still not getting that full communication. What's great is that those meters, once they're powered, they will connect back to the radio tower. So potentially, they're still communicating with that meter if they haven't turned it off. Okay? So things could be still passed on there. But, it's not the side of my house. I walk outside, I walk by my smart meter, and it's weakened at me madly because I want to talk to that optical board.
How many of you in here are going to stay for the next talk in this track, Tenacious Digging? Raise your hand if you're staying for that talk. How many of you were planning to go to FX's talk? Shit, did you help count? All right.
Everybody give me a big hand. Thanks, sir. Everybody lied, right? Okay, but in order to communicate with it, I have to understand what it's made of. Basically, it's just developed according to a standard. They all have to do it the same way, maybe. But it's just IR, IR LEDs. Well, so what's the first thing I do? I'm like, IR LEDs. Yeah, there's plenty of projects out there that do that. Plenty of projects online. But they don't do it the same way. Okay, and they don't do it that's easy to do for async serial. I was in a time crunch, so I bit the bullet and spent $350 on the optical probe because you can buy them online. A little expensive, but no big deal. And I get it, and I'm like, woohoo! And then I plug it in, and I look, and I've got TCY USB 0. USB to serial. Woohoo! Because my FTDI chip, the one that I've been sending for my hardware client, was the same thing. So I'm halfway, I'm even closer. I'm one step closer because I don't really have to modify that much more. $350 is kind of expensive. I did try, there is an open source project out there that somebody set up, but they didn't outline the pins to a normal serial that I'm used to. I'm not really good at modifying boards just yet. So I contacted the people that make one of the IR dongles at GuanaWorks. Actually, we helped fund some of this research, and they were able to get an initial production. It doesn't quite work just yet, but what's great is not only do they have USB, but we also made a module that has a serial out. So now I can plug in things like an XP module that you see right here, a cellular modem. Now I can start making wireless optical probes. People are doing this. $350 expensive. This will probably run between $50 and $75, if they told me correctly. If you're interested in this project, please contact GuanaWorks so that they know there's interest and they can do continue development of it. But what do I need to do? I've got a client that will send data, but I need to respond. In order to speak with optical port, I really need to respond intelligently. Okay, so really I've done pretty much all of those things, except for the response part. And so that's what I did.